upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children.
Thank you, Bishop Bowles. I will continue by saying good morning and welcome to the New Testament Church of God Harvest Temple. For those who are present in this service, and also I extend this welcome to those who are viewing this service online. Family, friends, ministers, and laity. Those who are viewing, let me just advise you that an electronic copy of today's order of service is available from the national website. And we hope that this goes some way in helping you to feel part of the proceedings today. Let me offer greetings to our national bishop and his wife, Bishop Dr. Donald Bowles, Sister Joycelyn Bowles. I also want to offer greetings to Bishop Dr. Derek Webley and the National Executive Council. I wish also to acknowledge Bishop Brian Robinson, who will be officiating the interment this afternoon, and Reverend Phyllis Thompson, who will be sharing in this service today. Lastly, I want to offer greetings to the ministers who are present in this service and to a number of ministers who are also in the vicinity and form part of the Guard of Honour. To the Lyseight family, on the behalf of my wife and I, New Testament Church of God Harvest Temple and the churches on the district of Wolverhampton, I want to offer sincere and heartfelt condolences to you. Since we have heard of the passing of our dear Mother Lyseight, you have been in our prayers and in our thoughts. And may you draw near to God in this service, which is an act of worship, and receive the peace that he offers to you in this moment. We gather in the name of Christ to give thanks for a godly, honourable, iconic woman of God, who was well loved and respected in the church and in the community. Indeed, Mother Rose Lyseight is the founding mother of the New Testament Church of God, England and Wales. The last surviving individual from who I call the Magnificent Seven, who gathered on the 20th of September 1953 for the very first public service that was held by this denomination in England and Wales. However, we must recognise that to you, the family, this great woman of God is your mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, aunt, and a dear friend. The order of service today reflects the sentiments of Mother Rose Lyseight, and indeed will celebrate her life and personality. And just on a lighter note, as we were coming in, Mother Lyseight is still having influence on this service. And yes, we give God the glory that we have come through, and we pray and trust that the rest of this day will go well. And in all that we do, God will be honoured and he will be glorified. And I ask you to say amen to that. So let us be upstanding for the opening hymn, which is Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. May I invite you to receive the ministry of New Testament Church of God Creative Arts as we worship along.
Okay.
It is appropriate and fitting that we mark her parting by observing a minute of silence. Let us reflect on the personal memories that we have of our most precious mother. Perhaps wherever you are, whether in this service or wherever you're viewing this service from, if you are able to stand, please be upstanding as we hold the memories of our dear mother close in our hearts and give God thanks for her life and for her contribution to our church and to our community. Let us observe a minute of silence. Please remain standing. Now invite Reverend Phyllis Thompson to come and lead us in prayer.
First, I'd like to give my condolences to the family, and we will pray together. You may be seated whilst I pray, but when we say the Lord's Prayer or when we pray the Lord's Prayer, please stand. Let us pray. Father, great and creator God, we join with the psalmist today in our reflection and celebration of life, the life of Mother Lyseight and the gift of eternal life. Thank you for making us your work of art. Your workmanship is marvelous. You saw us before we were born. You watched over us as we were being formed in our mother's womb, and have given us the privilege to be guided by you throughout our life's journey. Thank you, Lord, for being our strength in our weakness. Thank you for being our strength and our strong deliverer in the storms of life. Thank you for your unfailing love and care. How precious, Lord, are your thoughts about us. They cannot be numbered. We can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. Thank you for the hope of our faith, the gift of eternal life. Help us to live our lives in harmony with your purpose, so that like Mother Lyseight, we too can leave this world in the assurance of eternal life in your presence, where there is fullness of joy. Amen. Please stand with me as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Phyllis. Please be seated. I will now invite Mr. Mark Lyseight to come and to read the first pair of scripture readings for this morning. Please come, sir.
Good morning. Good afternoon. The first scripture reading today is from Psalm chapter 5, verses 11 to 12. But let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Let them also love thy name, be joyful in thee. For thou, Lord, wilt bless the righteous, with favor wilt thou compass him as with a shield. The next reading is from Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting these things which are left behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Mark, for those scripture readings. May God bless you. God's peace continue to journey with you. We will now be receiving three tributes. I will go through them as listed in the order of service, and then I would like them to proceed without a further announcement. So the first one is coming to us from Mrs. Joycelyn Bolt, who is the National Director of Women's Discipleship Ministry. And then following that tribute, I'm going to ask for the technical team to be ready to bring to us a tribute from Dr. Timothy Hill, Presiding Bishop of Church of God International, followed by a tribute from Bishop Ted Roy Powell, Presiding Bishop of Church of God of Prophecy, UK. Can we put our hands together and warmly welcome Mrs. Joycelyn Bolt.
Good morning to you all. I would like to express my heartfelt condolences to the Lyseight family. I am deeply touched and privileged to be able to give this tribute on behalf of the women of our church and myself. In 1964, Mother Lyseight established the Ladies Willing Workers Band for the purpose of teaching, evangelizing, education, discipleship, and fundraising. It is known today as Women's Discipleship Ministries. Under the umbrella of the Ladies Willing Workers Band, young adult, women's ministry, young women's ministry, and children ministries was organized. The women's ministry has impacted countless lives over the past 56 years, providing scholarship for students to complete their theological training and ministry has supported missionaries sent from the UK to Ghana, Liberia, Nigeria, and other countries. As a result of Mother Lyseight's vision, the ministry has grown to what is today a fully functioning, vibrant ministry within our churches, which seeks to minister to all women, regardless of their age, culture, or status. Mother Lyseight was a trailblazer, a visionary. A visionary. Mother Lyseight was somewhat special to the women's ministry. It is difficult to find words for this special, special mother that the Lord had loaned to us. Mother Lyseight was an encourager. She was a good listener. She was a good supporter. For instance, when I came into office 2014, she kept saying to me, "You're going to be all right. You're going to be all right." And it felt so good to know that Mother Lyseight is saying, "Don't worry, I'm with you in prayer and support." She didn't say that. She was a wise woman. What she said, "You're going to be all right." And that was enough for me. That was enough assurance for me that I am going to be all right. I am deeply honored to have known Mother Lyseight. I think 3 to 4 weeks before Mother Lyseight went into hospital, I rang her and we were talking and laughing and just reflecting back and the retreats we've had, the conferences we had, and she was so happy. She was so happy and she had expressed that. And indeed, I am grateful for this wonderful woman that the Lord has given unto us. So yes, Mother Lyseight was a trailblazer. She was a woman who loved God, loved people, loved to see the work of God carry out with excellence. And she would express that. When we have retreat, at the end of the retreat, she would say, "Yes, that was very good. How did you do it? I can't understand how you people do it." This is Mother Lyseight. That's our mother. That's our mother. She loved to embrace women of all ages. Her legacy will live on. The Women's Discipleship Ministry will continue to build on the foundation led by Mother Lyseight. Foundations of prayer, fasting, holiness, integrity, and commitment. I am grateful for the prayers and the encouragements and the counseling she gave me and for the example that she has set as I follow in her footsteps. To the Lyseight family, I want to thank you for sharing your mother with us and the sacrifice you have made over the many years. Is deeply appreciated. Please be assured of our continued prayers, and support. Mother Lyseight was an exceptional woman. An exceptional woman of God. I called her the Rose of the New Testament Church of God, England and Wales. Thank you.
As the General Overseer of the Church of God, I am so humbled and honored to be able at this moment to greet you on behalf of the entire Executive Committee as we commemorate and celebrate the life, the legacy, the love of Sister Rose Lyseight. When I think of impact, when I think of someone who has made a difference, I think of Brother and Sister Lyseight. Together, Oliver and Rose Lyseight founded the Church of God, the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales. And from those humble beginnings, laying a very deep and a strong foundation, the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales has become what it is today. Line upon line, here a little, there a little, God has used people just like the Lyseights to make an impact and an incredible difference in the harvest. Today, some 30,000 members, some 110 congregations, and it continues to grow. But it all goes back to those days of early seed planting and sowing, the foundation that was laid. When I think of Sister Lyseight particularly, I think of that radiant, brilliant smile. As a matter of fact, just a few days ago, I saw a photograph, a picture that was provided to our department here in World Missions. And that radiant, brilliant smile, effervescent, illuminating the room. And I've read of so many things of Sister Lyseight's impact upon people. I keep using that word because that's the word that is appropriate. Impact upon young ministers' wives, upon pastors' wives, ministry throughout England and Wales. Please know that as we grieve her passing, we celebrate her life. And there are people in heaven today because of this woman of God. You know, often when I'm asked to speak at life celebrations or funerals, I make this statement, and I'll make it today. We are not gathered today because someone died. We're gathered today because someone lived. And in living, she made a difference on all of you that are watching and throughout the Church of God. May God bless you and know that our prayers are with you today.
On behalf of the Church of God of Prophecy in the United Kingdom, Netherlands and Belgium, I express profound condolences for myself, a national presiding bishop, and my wife and family, to the Lyseight family, a Bishop Bolt, and the leadership, the eldership of the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales. I do so on the passing of a virtuous woman, a woman of God, Mother Rose Lyseight, founding mother of the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales, and wife to the late pioneering pastor, one of Britain's greatest pioneering and missionary leaders, the Reverend Dr. Oliver A. Lyseight, who has gone to be with the Lord. We are indeed saddened at the passing of Mother Lyseight, and today we sit with you in the house of mourning, doing so in the knowledge, the clear knowledge and understanding that Mother Lyseight, who has left such a great legacy as a virtuous woman, a wife who stood with her husband through all the various seasons and journeys across the United Kingdom, ensuring that the gospel of the kingdom has been and is being advanced, have left a legacy which will be hard to follow. But we thank God for her, and as we sit in the house of mourning, we are confident and we are comforted by the words of Job, Job 1:21, the Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And so we sit with you in this house of mourning, in the knowledge, in the understanding that Mother Lyseight has gone to be with the Lord. May God keep you. May he bless you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace always, is our prayers. Thank you.
Let us acknowledge the three tributes that we just received from Mrs. Joycelyn Bolt, Dr. Timothy Hill, and Bishop Ted Roy Powell. Let us appreciate those tributes. Amen. I want to say thank you to all three of you, and we receive those with open hearts, and I'm sure they are of great encouragement to the family. God bless you. It's time to receive now the second set of scripture readings, which will be read for us by Ms. Doreen Sylvester. Let's welcome her as she comes to read.
Good afternoon, church. The first scripture reading will be read from 2 Timothy 4, verse 5-8. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Second scripture verse, John 14, verse 1-3. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. There where I am, there ye may be also.
Say amen to the reading of God's holy word. Thank you, Mrs. Sylvester, for reading the scripture for us today.
Our family, as Reverend Reuben has said, there have been, I think, hundreds of tributes that's come in, which if we were to read them, we'd be here all day, perhaps all week. So we've selected three, which we'll give a cross-section of the tributes that's come in to you as a family, encourage you and remembering your mother. The first one I shall read comes from Steve Clay, the Chief Executive Officer for the YMCA, and John Rowe, who's the chair of the organization, and they write in proud memory of the life of Rose Lyseight. We write to offer our sincerest condolences for the sad passing of the founding mother of the New Testament Church of God, Mrs. Rose Lyseight. It is with pride that we acknowledge the tremendous leadership shown by Rose and her late husband, Dr. Oliver Augustus Lyseight, in the founding of the New Testament Church of God in the United Kingdom. And we are humbled and honored with the small contribution the YMCA made at the time in providing premises for those first services in Stafford Street, Wolverhampton. Rose and Dr. Lyseight's legacy in being faithful to God's calling is vast. Now, with 110 churches and 30,000 congregants across the UK, but it also remains a local church in the thriving community of Wolverhampton. It is particularly satisfying to note that members of the New Testament Church of God in Wolverhampton have worked for many years and continue to work for the YMCA BCG, that's a Black Country Group, continuing the spiritual connection between the YMCA and the NTCG initiated by Rose and Dr. Lyseight. Rose and Dr. Lyseight's legacy inspire us at the YMCA to work together to create a diverse, just society and to hold fast to our values of extending God's kingdom and providing a service that allows people to belong, contribute, and thrive in mind, body, and spirit. Praying God's continued blessing for you. And then we have a tribute from Emma Reynolds, the former MP for Wolverhampton North East, 2010 to 2019. Mother Rose Lyseight was a great pioneer in the establishment of the New Testament Church of God in the UK, alongside her late husband, Bishop Dr. O.A. Lyseight. I want to pay particular tribute to her incredible work in supporting and championing women in the Women's Discipleship Ministry. I have fond memories of talking to Mother Rose about the history of the New Testament Church of God. She was always warm and so humble about her fantastic achievements and the development of the church she and her husband gave their lives to create and sustain. And the third and final tribute I'm going to read comes from His Excellency Seth George Ramakan, the High Commissioner for Jamaica. I was deeply saddened to learn of the passing of Mrs. Rose Lyseight, widow of late Reverend Dr. Oliver A. Lyseight, who established the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales. On behalf of the Government of Jamaica and the staff of the Jamaican High Commission, I would like to extend heartfelt condolences to the family, friends, and members of the Lyseight family, as well as to the New Testament Church of God. Mrs. Lyseight and Dr. Oliver Lyseight were members of the pioneering Windrush generation who answered the call to assist in rebuilding Britain following the Second World War. Regrettably, as a Christian couple, they were made to feel unwelcome by the established churches in Britain at the time, and as a consequence, they were motivated to organize their own meetings, which led to the establishment of the New Testament Church of God in England and Wales. Mrs. Lyseight, the founding mother, along with her husband, Dr. Lyseight, led the church for 25 years from 1953 to 1978 and contributed to the phenomenal growth in both membership and reach. The New Testament Church of God in England and Wales now stands tall as a beacon of the Christian church in the United Kingdom, as well as a central part of the Caribbean diaspora here in the UK. Although I did not have the privilege of meeting Mrs. Lyseight, I understand that she was an exceptional leader who made a significant contribution to the development of the Jamaican community in the United Kingdom and had a positive impact on the wider society. She is credited for bringing the Women's Discipleship Ministries to the United Kingdom in 1964 and remains an inspiration to women in the church and the wider community. I can well imagine how difficult it must be for her family, friends, and the church community. You can, however, take solace in the knowledge that she was loved and respected, and that fond memories of time shared with her will be etched in the hearts of all who interacted with her. Please accept our prayers and the best wishes during this difficult time.
Thank you, Reverend Phyllis, for bringing to us those honorable New Testament Church of God, England and Wales. Let's receive that tribute now.
Following the post-war invitation from the government, Caribbean families began to settle in Britain. Many, including the Lyseight family who arrived in 1951, found some of the white British congregations were less than welcoming.
We discovered some were saying that they have been to other places and they're not welcome. Nevertheless, this did not allow us to have any animosity against the folks. So there was no place in me to have any hatred, because the Lord was leading us through all these situations.
Rose's husband, Oliver, took matters into his own hands, and in Wolverhampton, he founded the UK branch of the American New Testament Church of God, inviting newly arrived families to join.
He did the preaching, and I did the singing. Between 1953 to 1956, the church grew. I mean, grew immensely.
The congregation Oliver founded over 60 years ago is still thriving today and is known as Harvest Temple. It's one of a network of 130 churches across the country with over 30,000 members.
How do you feel now about the fact that the denomination is all over the country?
When I look back and see now the expansion, the growth of this organization, I am really amazed. And this allows me to know how great God is.
When Oliver died in 2006, the funeral attracted huge crowds eager to celebrate the life of a man who had brought a new Christian denomination to the UK.
When we arrived there, I just realized how important my husband was. It was so beautifully done.
What do you think Oliver would think about the growth and the development of the church?
Oh, he would fall off his chair. We are blessed. And honestly speaking, I am enjoying it to the fullness of my life. And I give God all the praise and all the glory.
Holy Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your great name, which was, and which is, and which is to come. And we are looking forward to your return. Now your people are gathered to worship you. But as we have just heard, we want to have the audience clear of transgressions. We want to worship you today in holiness, in righteousness, in purity of heart. Glory to your name. What a love, what a peace, what a joy you have given to us, the human race. You love the world so much, you gave your son, died such an ignominious death, disgraceful death, but we are glad to know when he said, it is finished. The debt is paid. And he is now seated at your right hand, making intercession for us. We praise you, Lord. And we thank you for your gift. The gift of your son. What a name. 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 Call his name Jesus, and we give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor for setting the human race free at last.
yes, we do give God the glory. Now, how moving was that to hear Mother Lyseight's voice and to see her in full flow, always full of the fire of God, always ready. If you call on her any moment in any service, she has a word, and not just any word, a prophetic word, a word that would resound in your heart, always ready, a great encourager. We are going to miss her so much. And despite, you know, sometimes the technology lets us down, it doesn't work. But thank God for the technology that captures that sort of testimony, that sort of prayer, that sort of witness. We give God thanks. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. A wonderful, wonderful woman of God. She's a superstar. When we had the interview here with Songs of Praise, the first clip was from Songs of Praise. I mean, I think the crew was just in awe of Mother Lyseight, and she just flowed with it, you know, no nerves or anything. She was just naturally gifted just to share from her heart, and she represented us well. Amen. We are so proud of her and her legacy. I'm going to invite you to be upstanding as we continue with the second hymn that comes to us. Please be upstanding.
When I was to remember,
And that's what's going to be like, you know, when we live on this earth. And one day we will slip out of this life into eternity, to a place where we will be worshipping and singing. But until then, we will go on singing. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to receive a photographic tribute from the Lyseight family.
Me home here in the power of Christ. me home. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
Okay, coming to us now is Mrs. Yolanda Nelson, who will be sharing the eulogy with us. Let's put our hands together and give her a very warm welcome.
Good afternoon, church. I greet you in Jesus' name. I stand to read the eulogy on behalf of my cousins, and then I will do a little bit at the end for my own tribute. Mrs. Rose Adassa Lyseight, wife of the late Reverend Dr. Oliver A. Lyseight, was born in Kingston, Jamaica, the 16th of January, 1928. She was the eldest of her two siblings, Joyce and Keith, of whom she was very fond. Both passed on some years before her. Whilst growing up, Rose lived with her aunt Lynn in Kingston, where she also attended church. Her schooling took place there too, as well as in other localities within Jamaica. It is understood that in her mid-teens, Rose relocated to the country where her mother and other relatives were living. In 1941, Rose became a Christian. She attended church regularly along with her good friend, Imogen. Rose was fervent in her worship and encouraging others to commit to the Christian pathway. One of Rose's male cousins regaled how, as a young boy, she encouraged by her to attend church. This E.E. did rather reluctantly after a while, but was then reprimanded by Rose for not dressing respectfully enough to a place of worship. During her time in the country, Rose developed an interest in baking and a love of Chinese cuisine. This interest resulted from her helping her uncle-in-law, who was an accomplished chef and baker, among other things. Rose later returned to Kingston, where she engaged in developing her dressmaking skills, other interests being music and singing, as well as cake baking. In June 1947, at the age of 19, Rose married Oliver, a young minister in the Church of God, Jamaica. Her cousin Alice, sitting here at the front, was a young bridesmaid. Although there are many pictures of Rose with family, friends, or other occasions, the family have never been able to satisfy their curiosity for pictures of this momentous union. By the fifth year of marriage, four children were born to Rose and Oliver in Jamaica. Rose left for England in 1953 to join her husband, who had emigrated there. The four children were left in the care of their grandmother in Jamaica. Over time in England, Rose and Oliver had another three children. The four older children arrived at different stages to join their parents in England. By this period, Oliver was heavily engaged in ministerial work throughout the UK. This involved nurturing newly planted churches, the foundation of the UK New Testament Church of God, NTCG, we have today. Rose ran the larger household in a regimental way, with the older children being assigned various tasks to assist the management of the home. Chores had to be performed, but unlike youngsters today, pocket money was never mentioned as part of the process. Other relatives also supported Rose, recognizing the importance of Oliver's ministerial work, in which he was fully occupied. Over time, Rose developed her interest in music and singing, learning to play the piano and using her musical abilities to good effects when she accompanied her husband in evangelical work. In the early days, for example, we can imagine her singing along with choruses such as, oh, what a wonderful thing, a very wonderful thing to be free from sin and have Christ within, to be made joint heirs with Jesus my Lord. What a wonderful, wonderful thing. Later on, as well as singing at events, she learned how to read sheet music. Then she advanced to coaching and directing the church choir. We're all blessed with different talents, serving God with these according to our calling. The Bible says that some are called to preach or teach, others to minister in song, to listen, guide, share, or support. Sometimes we struggle to unveil our life's purpose. However, Rose just went ahead and used the gifts God blessed her with to the best of her ability. One of her ardent faith since youth, Rose continued to develop an intense religious focus, even mindful that living in alignment with Christ's teaching would bring its own reward. In the mid-60s, Rose became president of the UK NTCG, Ladies Willing Workers Band, LWWB. She formalized the structure of the Ladies Willing Workers Band, management based on the format her husband Oliver had used on the ministerial side for the executive board. Under Rose's leadership, the Ladies Willing Workers Band went from strength to strength, from which she was commended. It evolved into what is now known as the Women's Ministry. From the late 70s, Rose worshipped at the NTCG Bilston, where husband Oliver ministered at that time until his retirement. For the most part, however, Rose attended service at NTCG in Wolverhampton. It was in Wolverhampton, with Rose as founder member, that the fledgling church began services at the YMCA in the 50s, moving to a location at Nursery Street in the 60s. Finally settling at Harvest Temple, Wenisfield Road, Wolverhampton, where we are today. Rose was fully involved in this journey. Her participation in services at Harvest Temple only ended owing to the COVID-19 lockdown in March of 2020. Whilst attending services at Harvest Temple and other special events, Rose would comment approvingly of how exceptionally well things were being conducted, and often remarked how impressed she was by the quality of the stage performance and renditions of the young people at these events. She continuously appraised the progress of the UK NTCG from its early inception to current times. Throughout her years of service, Rose received many accolades in recognition of her contribution. The many tributes dedicated to Rose in order of service reflected the enormous contribution and impact she made. However, one of the main achievements Rose aspired towards is, as referenced in the scripture, Colossians 3:24 and 2 Timothy 4:8, to serve God and look forward to a heavenly reward surpassing that of a mortal life we will on earth. Rose was a stylish and charismatic woman, often sought after by interviews from different sources, for example, being interviewed by the BBC, Songs of Praise. Rose responded admirably. Both young and old folks were drawn to her. She remained vibrant and energetic in her advanced years, taking on roles that many far younger than herself may well have found challenging. Although Rose could be somewhat reticent of matters of age and personal details dependent on her audience, she was always passionately open with extolling the virtues of living the Christian life and encouraging others on that pathway. On morality, Rose was fully aware of the scriptures. For as in Adam, all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive, 1 Corinthians 15 and 22. In the words of others, Rose had been described as a veteran, fighter, warrior, precious diamond, stalwart, and strong. Here we might venture that the joy of the Lord was her strength. In conclusion, it can be said that Rose lived a full, varied, and interesting life. For example, traveled to Africa and other countries, of which the spiritual element was paramount. This eulogy is but a synopsis and essence of this unique individual, Rose Lyseight, whose life spanned 92 years. Today we celebrate her life and legacy and bid a fond farewell to Mom, Grandma, Great-Grandma, Auntie Rose, Cousin Rose, Sister Mother Lyseight, by which she is remembered. Mrs. Lyseight is survived by 5 children, 7 grandchildren, 11 great-grandchildren, as well as numerous nieces, of which I'm one, and nephews and cousins. And that is the tribute from children. And I will just quickly just read my quick tribute to my Auntie Rose, which will probably be very different from my cousins, as I spent quite some time with my Aunt Rose. And I just want to say this of her, bless the Lord. To talk about Rose Lyseight is to speak of a Jamaican lady, one who emigrated to England and lived as full a life as she could in spite of challenges. To say she was excited about God would be an understatement. Her excitement was evident throughout her whole life. My sisters Doreen, Valder, and sometime Rose and myself visited on numerous occasions, especially to celebrate Aunt Rose's birthday. Then she made friends with my daughter Melanie at convention. Such jubilation with the rest of her brother's children made surprise visits. You were elated and happy to look at the nieces and nephews. Whatever the subject, Aunt would tell it with such exuberance. I'm sure you've experienced that today, that you would soon be drawn in. She would sometimes stand on tiptoes, am I right, when she's telling you anything, because she was so excited, as though tipping toes would increase her height. She celebrated all of my achievements. When I was ordained as pastor, when I graduated, she constantly reminded me, I'm praying for you, because she knew of my challenges. Aunt Rose loved avocado pears. Did you know that? She loved avocado pears. And the same can be said, as my cousin said, about food. She loved Chinese food, having grown up with our Chinese family. Aunt also loved a good sleep. Did you know she liked sleeping? Recently, I stayed over with Auntie Rose, and it so happens that I didn't sleep very well that night. And she said, did you sleep well? And I said, no. I said, I kept getting up because I didn't feel very well. Her reply was, oh, sorry to hear that. That time me in a Jerusalem and never hear a thing. She was very funny. If you shared anything exciting with her or good news, her response would be, no bother me. But don't think that this well-lived life came without heartache and pain. She lost her mother, her husband, her only sister, her only brother, which was my dad, 2 sons. So I hear her saying, like Job, if a man die, shall he live again? I hear her saying, I just want to know, shall he live again? I've been through so much. I only want to know if I die, if I will live again. And then I hear her saying, I know my Redeemer lives, and I shall see him on that day. So my beautiful Aunt Rose, as you always say to me when I'm leaving after a visit, walk good and get home safe. God bless you.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Yolanda Nelson, for bringing the eulogy to us, and for your wonderful tribute. Also, I think we should show our appreciation again. That was absolutely wonderful. Yeah.
Hallelujah, yeah. One day, we're gonna make meet our loved ones again in that new Jerusalem. Be encouraged. Yeah, 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 yeah. Ooh. Yeah, yeah.
Worthy is there.
Oh, I want to go to the city so.
Let me invite you to be upstanding as we receive an address and prayer for the family from Bishop Dr. Donald Bolt, the administrative bishop for New Testament Church of God, England and Wales. Let's receive Bishop Bolt as he comes to us. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop King. Please be seated. I have written a piece on page 11 of your brochure, which I give some description there of Mother Rose Lyseight. So if you don't hear very much from me, you can read that piece in your own time. I am deeply honored to be able to stand today to give you a very short address for the homegoing of Mother Rose Adassa Lyseight. On behalf of my wife and myself, the leadership, members, and friends of New Testament Church of God, England and Wales, I'd like to offer our sincere condolences to the Lyseight family, to Newton, Neville, Delrose, Elaine, Sharon, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, the extended family. And I want you to know that we are committed to praying for you and with you in the days ahead and the months as the case might be. There is no doubt in my mind that Mother Rose Lyseight was a Proverbs 31 woman. And I won't try to go into all of the detail of the description of that person. But I'd say today that we are surely going to miss her. And it's always difficult to lose those we love. But it is especially difficult when we are dealing with someone like Mother Rose Lyseight, the founding mother of our church. However, in the midst of our grief, we can remember Mother Lyseight with joy, and we can have great gratitude for her life. Let me bring you to scripture from the book of 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 15 through 17 and 1 Corinthians 15, 19, 20. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15, 19, 20. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. My thought today is about the Christian hope. The Christian hope. And that great evangelist, Dr. Billy Graham, speaking of death, he said this. He said, death is the most democratic experience in life, for we all participate in it. We think of it happening to only other people. We don't like to grow old and we don't like to die. However, he said, the Bible teaches that death is an enemy of man and of God. But it also teaches that this enemy, death, will ultimately be destroyed forever. That in fact it has already been defeated at the cross and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The believer will be like Jesus and we shall be like Christ in love. So much of self is involved in what we do here. But one day in Christ we shall have perfect love. What a glorious time that will be, he said, when we get to heaven. You know, the Bible is replete with evidence of the Christian hope. That most famous of verses in John 3 16 declares, "For God so loved that he gave his only begotten Son, that those who believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life." So we know that. It is also true from the text that was read this afternoon. Jesus says, "I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there he may be also." And you heard the Thessalonian text making mention that the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. It is a hope that goes beyond the grave. It's a hope that goes beyond the grave. And you hear the Apostle Paul echoing it, that if in this life only we have hope, we would be of all men most miserable. But let me rush back to the Thessalonian text where Paul says, he says, I want you to understand that those who have died in the Lord, they are not going to precede us. They won't get to heaven before we do. And as I look down the ages, I can see kings and queens waiting for us and waiting for Mother Lyseight. She's going to join their ranks. And you will be interested to know that she is not going to get there before us. She's going to wait for us, and together we will caught up to be with him, with her in the air. I can see David, I can see Esther, I can see prophets and patriarchs waiting for us. Can you imagine that? I can see Isaac and Jacob, Anna and Samuel, Moses and Joseph. And I think of Dr. Oliver Lyseight, for example. I think of Dr. Jeremiah McIntyre. I think of Dr. Selwyn Arnold. I think of Bishop Ron Brown. They are all waiting for us. Isn't that something? In fact, not only those names that I call, but all the saints of all the ages, with the exception of Elijah and Moses who went to heaven, they're all waiting for us. And Mother Lyseight is going to that place to wait for us. What a wonderful privilege. I'm going to bring it to a close. But, you know, talk about the Christian hope. You get people facing death have different experience. Those who are dying without hope leave their last words. So, for example, O. Henry said, "Turn up the lights. I don't want to go out in the dark." Thomas Hobbes says, "I am about to take my final leap, a great leap in the dark." But famous other people who have hope in Christ says, Joseph Addison said, "Seeing what peace a Christian can die." And John Wesley, he says before his death in March 2nd, 1791, John Wesley opened his eyes and exclaimed in a strong, clear tone, "The best thing about dying is that God is with us. God is with us." I wonder for time if we was at the bedside and we could hear Mother Lyseight's last words. I wonder what there would be. I guess it could be something like this: "It pays to serve Jesus. I speak from my heart. He'll always be with us if we do our part. There is naught in this wide world can pledge us afford. There's peace and contentment in serving the Lord." Or it might be, "I'm so glad I've learned to trust him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end." Or might it be, "Though we are placed in the tomb amid the sorrow and gloom, when Gabriel's trumpet shall sound, we shall arise." Mother Lyseight was such a woman. Let us emulate her and live our lives to please God, so that when our time comes, like John Wesley, we can say, "The good thing about dying is that God is with us." I know that our time's up, and therefore I am going to stop at this point. But let me tell you, Mother Lyseight, when we all get to heaven, we will go to a beam of judgment and to be rewarded for the work that we've done. So the text says she's fought a good fight, she's kept the faith, and now there is laid up for her a crown of righteousness which the Lord himself shall give to us. My friends, my brothers, my sisters, Let us remember that God himself will wipe away all tears from our eyes, and there shall be no more sickness, neither shall there be any more dying or any more pain. And I'm going to invite you to stand with me as we pray for the family and bring this element of the service to its conclusion. Let us pray. Merciful God, you have made us all and given us your Son for our redemption. We commend our Mother Rose Adassa Lyseight to your perfect mercy and wisdom, for in you alone we put our trust. Father of all mercies and God of all consolation, you pursue us with unfailing love, and dispel the shadow of death with the bright dawn of light. Give courage, we pray, to the Lyseight family in their loss and in their sorrow. Be their refuge and strength, O Lord. Assure them of your continuing love, and lift them from the depths of grief into the peace and light of your presence. Come alongside your people this day and remind them of your eternal presence, and give them your comfort and your strength. We pray especially for Newton, for Neville, for Delrose, for Elaine, for Sharon, the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, and the extended family. And we pray also, Lord, for those family members who are at home and abroad who could not be here today. I pray that they will feel your presence near them and your arms around them thrown. Lord, give them all they need for rejoicing, all they need for hope and peace. Be with them here and everywhere. Be present now and always. Fulfiller of our past, strength of our present, and promise of our future. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And all God's people say, amen.
Can we show our appreciation to Bishop Dr. Bolt for bringing that tribute to us? Thank you, sir. May God continue to bless you and have his hand of favor upon you. Please be seated. The final tributes service today will be the presentation of the New Testament Church of God flag, followed by the presentation of a book of tributes. So can I invite at this time to formally receive the presentation of the New Testament Church of God flag, Mark and Sarah Lyseight. Please remain, Mark and Sarah, please remain there. Normally we would have a book of condolences, but in light of the current situation, the National Office of the New Testament Church of God has organized to receive tributes, and they have flooded in from across the UK and from across the world. It's not possible to reflect or to share all these tributes in this service today, so a book of tributes has been compiled and will now be presented. And I'm going to ask that Mr. Newton Lyseight, please, if you can stand where you are, as the chief mourner for the family. This book of tributes will be presented to you to share with the family, and we hope that it will be a source of comfort, strength, and hope to you over the coming days, weeks, and months ahead. today's proceedings have not come to an end yet, but at this juncture, I just want to say thank you to everybody for your prayers, for your support, for your patience, and for your understanding. I'm going to be asking in a while the funeral directors to prepare us for the recessional as we leave from Harvest Temple Sanctuary and head towards Danes Court Cemetery. Let us stand for the pronunciation of a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Amen. Funeral directors, can you prepare us for the recessional, please? And I'm going to ask that whatever musical or video tribute is ready, that we will exit this sanctuary to that.
in heaven, prepared for me when the toils of this life is over.
I stay no longer with you. Goodbye. Scripture, please.
I stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
To go God's way the rest of my life. By world, I stay no longer with you. By pleasures of sin, I stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life.
We're able to go forward then. We are gathered here today then to lay to rest the body of our beloved sister Rose Adassa Lyseight. The scripture teaches us that our bodies are made of dust from the ground, and to the dust in the ground we will return. But we are more than dust. For when God breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, man became a living being. God breathed his spirit into our temporary bodies, and that is what lives on today. These bodies serve to us just as a temporary dwelling place for our bodies and our restless spirits. The scriptures say, we know that if our earthly tent be destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. So even committing our bodies to the ground is a testimony of the resurrection, because this is a temporary home from which we leave to be with God. But as we stand here today at this moment at this graveside, our thoughts are reminded of another tomb wherein the body of Christ was laid, but after 3 days from there he triumphantly rose again eternally to die no more. And so standing by this grave, let us also remember the grave of Christ, and let us take his resurrection as God's testimony to us and on behalf of our dear sister Lyseight, that she will not remain here forever, nor the dead in Christ, but we will be raised together to be with him. Can I just invite you then to bow your heads for a moment of prayer? Lord Jesus Christ, by your own 3 days in the tomb, you hallowed the graves of all who believe in you, and so made a grave a sign of hope that promises resurrection, even as it claims our mortal bodies. Grant that our sister may sleep here in peace until you awake her to glory. For you are the resurrection and the life. Then she will see you face to face, and in your light will see light, and know the splendor of God, for you live and reign forever. Amen. For as much then as it has pleased God Almighty to take out of this world the soul of our dearly beloved Rose Adassa Lyseight, we therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, dust to dust, and ashes to ashes, looking for that blessed hope when the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore Paul says, comfort one another with these words. At this time we want to hand over to our graveside crew, who will do the backfill for us, after which we will have our ceremony of releasing the doves.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm probably going to ask us for our safety if we create a one-way system. So if you could come through by where this young lady is standing, file past the feet of Mother Lyseight's casket, and then go back to the cars, please. Thank you. Be careful as you come through. Bishop, are you one of the last?
You will be called back after the back filling.
So we go right back down by where the cars are. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Go to where the mat is at the end, it's safer for you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, family. You okay? Be careful as you come through, family. Yes, we can do. Keep singing, that's beautiful.
I'm going home on the morning train. I'm going home on the morning train. I am going home on the morning train. For the evening train will be too late. I am going home on the morning train.
Thank you so much.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved on earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the rolling flood of yonder I'll be there. When the rolling flood of yonder, Savior in the sky. Oh, and oh, our Savior.
There's
another song.
I'll fly away.
I'll fly away.
We've got weeping may in joy for the night. Joy comes in the morning. Weeping may and joy for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Oh, weeping may and joy for a night.
Joy comes
in the morning. Oh, hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Joy comes in the morning. Weeping may and joy for a night. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Joy comes in the morning. Weeping may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Oh, weeping may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Joy comes in the morning. Oh, weeping may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Weeping may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Hallelujah for the joy. Joy comes in the morning.
Joy comes
in the morning.
Joy comes
in the morning.
Joy comes
in the morning.
Hallelujah.
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 What
I'll fly away.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
what
have
we got?
Okay, I'll fly away.
Glory.
Yeah.
Okay.
What we got?
I'll fly away.
I'll fly away.
Glory.
Gentlemen.
And I'll fly away. Oh, glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah. By and by.
Slightly
on
to the left.
What, right?
Yeah.
Return to heaven with a dove, return on your skyward flight. We send your spirit with our love. Go now with angels of white.
One, ladies and gentlemen.
Fly away, oh glory.
Round of applause, please.
Give the benediction. I want to invite your pastor, Bishop Reuben, to pray this final prayer for the family.
Thank you, Bishop Brown. Just before I pray, I just want to, on the behalf of the family, say thank you to family, friends, ministers, the whole entire team, funeral directors, the technical team. It's listed on the back of the order of service, an acknowledgement, but I want to publicly do that and thank God for his grace that has kept us from the outset of this day and allowed us to bid farewell to Mother Lyseight in a fitting way. And what a beautiful arrangement of flowers that we see before us that represents a life that was lived to the full.
Yes, sir.
And to the glory of God, a beautiful soul, and we will continue to treasure the memories of her in our hearts and live out the legacy. You know, one of the things that really makes my heart full of joy is that Mother Lyseight was privileged to live, to see the outworking of that work that started. You know, every time I would see her in church on Sunday, it just filled my heart with gladness. When she would come to the national events, and just to have that privilege to look around and see so many additions to the church on that journey. God really blessed her and granted her the privilege to witness all of that, and we give him the glory for that. Let us bow our heads together for prayer. God our Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your peace. Again, we thank you for the life of Mother Lyseight. As we have commemorated her life, celebrated her life and personality today. A true, honorable woman of God, Lord, who served her generation and beyond and fulfilled the purpose for which she was sent into this earth. We thank you that her remains, Lord, are in its resting place. Lord, and as we prepare to leave from here, I lift up again to you the family and ask for your peace for today and hope for tomorrow. Lord, will you walk with each member of the family, both individually and collectively, Lord, in the days and weeks and months ahead. Lord, in difficult and challenging times that are sure to come because we are human, I pray, Lord, you will help each member to learn to cling to you, Lord, in the eye of every storm. And may the reality of your presence bring strength and comfort to each heart. Thank you for this blessed day. Lord, we commend ourselves into your care. I pray for a safe onward journey from here for every person who is present, Lord, at this graveside service. And all other things we commend to you and commit to you now, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, as together we say amen, amen. And amen. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop King. I just want to say, Mark, Sarah, and all the family, how absolutely privileged I felt in being invited to participate in your day like this. My soul was really blessed for the sheer being part of your journey today. So now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the power of his grace, as together we await the Lord's coming again to receive all who live faithfully to him. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Grace and peace be with you all. Amen. God bless you.
Good night, beloved. Sleep and take your rest. Lay down your head upon thy Savior's breast. We love you well, but Jesus loves you best. Good night, good night, good night.
Bless the Lord. Amen. Good night, Mother Lyseight.